Father, and of the Son, and of the Holy Ghost. Beloved in the Lord, let us draw near with a true heart and confess our sins unto God our Father, beseeching Him in the name of our Lord Jesus Christ to grant us forgiveness. Our help is in the name of the Lord. I said, I will confess my transgressions unto the Lord. Against thee by thought, word, and deed. Wherefore, we flee for refuge to thy infinite mercy, seeking and imploring thy grace for the sake of our Lord Jesus Christ. O most merciful God, who hast given thy only begotten Son to die for us, have mercy upon us, and for his sake grant us remission of all our sins, and by thy Holy Spirit, increase in us true knowledge of thee, and of thy will, and true obedience to thy word, to the end that by thy grace we may come to everlasting life, through Jesus Christ our Lord. Amen. Almighty God, our heavenly Father, hath mercy upon us, and has given his only Son to die for us, and for his sake forgives us all our sins. To them that believe on his name, he giveth the power to become the sons of God, and has promised them his Holy Spirit. He that believeth and is baptized shall be saved. Grant this, Lord, unto us all. Please be seated as we join in our Christmas psalm reading, Psalm 98, and we read that response. Sing to the Lord a new song.
Lord, we have done marvelous things. His right hand and his holy arm have worked salvation for him.
The Lord has made his salvation known and revealed his righteousness to the great nation.
He has remembered his love and his faithfulness to the house of Israel. All the ends of the earth have seen the salvation of our
shout for joy to the Lord, all the earth. Burst into jubilant song with music.
Make music to the Lord with the harp and the song of saints.
Let the sea resound and everything in it, the world and all who live in it.
Let the rivers clap their hands, let the mountains sing together for joy.
Let them sing before the Lord.
For he comes to judge the earth.
He will judge the world in righteousness and the people with equity. Please rise as we join together in singing hymn 79, our exhortation hymn.
Thank you.
starts out the story of Jesus' birth by dating it with a tax registration, the one where Cyrenius was governor of Syria. Of all the things to use to date the birth of the Son of God, a tax registration? Luke could have used something else more exciting, more interesting. Perhaps the death of a famous person, the date of a battle, an invention or discovery of some important object. But he doesn't do this. Luke goes for something we hear in a human proverb. There's only two things guaranteed: life and taxes. Now, we could think of this as something funny, or in many times when we think of taxes, it's kind of boring. But then, life is filled with those kind of things for us, isn't it? It's filled with ordinary things, things that are often boring, things that are occasionally painful, like taxes. His life would be filled with ordinary things, Christ. Ordinary activities like sleeping and awakening, walking, eating, talking with friends, and so on. In fact, Christ's public ministry didn't even start until he was about 30 years old. Before that, what happened? Well, we know that his father, Joseph, was a carpenter, so we kind of think he probably knew how to build things. Probably helping him work. We know that they worshipped in the temple, because it tells us that. Helping care for the family. Those ordinary things that we all face. So ordinary that the gospel writers don't even write them down for us. But that was appropriate for our Savior, wasn't it? Because he had this life, a life like ours, to come to people like us to save us. People who didn't even know they needed saving. People that had work to do and taxes to pay and chores to do. Few of us are rich or famous. Our lives are not all that exciting all the time. But our need for the Savior, who fulfilled a law for us, who died to pay for our sins, a Savior who loves us, who understands us, is truly needed all the time. Christian worshipers, we will never not need Jesus in our lives, not even for a single moment. And because of God's love for us, we have our Lord and Savior more sure and certain than anything else, even death and taxes. So this morning, we journey with our children on the road to see this thing which the Lord has made known to us. Please bow your heads in prayer. Heavenly Father, as we celebrate the coming of the Christ child, we thank you for sending your Son to us. He became poor and lowly to raise us to his divine glory, eternal life in heaven. Through him we are called children of God. Give us strength then to live as your children, to grow in faith, in our ordinary world, to be your servants, and to share this message with others. Amen. Our children will now tell the story.
Thank you. It came to pass in those days that there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that all the world should be taxed. And this taxing was first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. So all went to be taxed, everyone into his own city. Joseph went out from Galilee, out of the city of Nazareth, into Judea, unto the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was in the house and lineage of David. He went to be taxed with his wife Mary, his espoused wife, being with child.
Thank you. And so it was that while they were there, the days were accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son, back to his swaddling clothes, and lying in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn.
Thank you.
and you shall find faith wrapped in twine, clothes, wine, and imagery.
We continue then with the congregation singing verses 6 through 8.
Oh,
Martin Luther said, I was yearning to understand Paul's epistle to the Romans. Up to that point, nothing had stopped me except this simple phrase, the righteousness of God in Romans 1, verse 17, where Paul says, the righteousness of God is revealed in the gospel.
Now, I hated the term righteousness of God because I had been taught that means that God is righteous in himself and is good, and he punishes all sinners that are unrighteous. I discovered that in the sight of God, I was a great sinner. My conscience was troubled and distressed. I also did not trust my ability to ease the anger of God and satisfaction in war. For this reason, I did not at all love this righteous and angry God who punishes sinners. Rather, I hated him and was full of secret anger towards him.
The congregation will now rise as we join in the responsive reading of Romans. Through one man, sin entered the world,
and death through sin,
and thus death spread to all men,
because of all sin.
For the wrath of God is revealed from heaven against all ungodliness
and unrighteousness of men.
They show the work of the law written in their hearts,
their conscience also bearing witness.
God will judge the secrets of man by Jesus Christ,
according to my gospel.
As it is written, there is none righteous, no, not one.
There is none who understands. There is none who seeks after God.
They have all turned aside. They have together become unprofitable.
There is none who does good, no, not one.
Now we know that whatever the law says, it says to those who are under the law,
that every mouth may be stopped, and all the world may become guilty before God.
Therefore, by the deeds of the law, no flesh will be justified in his sight.
For by the law is knowledge of sin.
For all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God.
For the wages of sin is death.
But the gift of God is eternal life in Christ Jesus our Lord. Please be seated for our next gift.
Thank you.
accepted.
I learned that the righteousness of God is his mercy, through which he regards us and keeps us righteous. At that point, I immediately felt that I had been born again and had found a door wide open, leading straight to paradise. As much as I hated the term righteousness of God before, I now loved and treasured it. This passage of Paul began before me a gate in heaven. If you have true faith in Christ, that Christ is your Savior, then once you have a gracious God. This is what it means to behold God in faith, that you should look upon his Father in your friendly heart, in which there is no end.
We continue with our response and reading. But now the righteousness of God apart from the law is revealed.
Even the righteousness of God through faith in Jesus Christ.
Therefore we conclude that a man is justified by faith alone.
Apart from the deeds of the law.
For I am not ashamed of the gospel of Christ, for it is the power of God to salvation for everyone who believes. For in it the righteousness of God is revealed from faith to faith, as it is written. Therefore, having been justified by faith,
we have peace with God through our Lord Jesus Christ.
But God demonstrates his own love towards us in that while we were still sinners,
Christ died for us.
For as by one man's disobedience many were made sinners,
so also by one man's obedience many will be made righteous.
There is therefore now no condemnation for those who are in Christ Jesus.
What then shall we say to these things? If God is for us, who can be against us?
He who did not spare his own Son, but delivered him up for us all, how shall he not with him
also freely give us all things?
Yet in all these things we are more than conquerors through him who loved us.
For I am persuaded that neither death nor life, nor angels, nor principalities, nor powers, nor things present, nor things to come,
nor height, nor depth, nor any other created thing,
shall be able to separate us from the love of God, which is in Christ Jesus our Lord.
We will now gather our offering. Please rise for prayer. Lord Jesus, you gave yourself unselfishly for our salvation as you came in your lowly birth, providing us with all that we need for our souls and body. Instill in us a spirit of generosity and unselfishness that makes us willing to bring our gifts to you, satisfy our personal needs, and even provide for us the means whereby we may help our neighbor and give offerings to your work. You placed your life in our service. We pray, dwell in us, cause us to live our lives to your glory, and give ourselves to you. Amen. Please be seated for our next hymn.
Receive the benediction. As you go your way,
May the Lord go with you. May he go before you to show you the way, behind you to befriend you, above you to watch over you, and within you to give you peace. Amen. Please be seated for our final prayer. Good morning.
Good morning.
And a Merry Christmas to all of you. As far as announcements, we do have our Christmas dinner coming up, so please stay for that. Other announcements, of course, is our Christmas Eve candlelight service at 4 o'clock here at Emmanuel, and then Christmas Day here at 10 o'clock. And then next Sunday, we will celebrate the Lord's Supper at our regular time. No confirmation class these next 2 weeks because Wednesday is on the Christmas Day and New Year's Day, so we'll do that. Are there any other announcements that we can make? We We thank our children and teachers for sharing with us, and all of you for helping with the program. When we have so few, it's a good way to have it all together with many songs and carols. And then let us join in the common table prayer, so I believe that we can start reading and get back.
Come, Lord Jesus, be our guest, and let these gifts to us be blessed. O give thanks unto the Lord, for he is good, for his mercy endures forever.